Hello friends, in this video we are going to see hyperbilirubinemia. In this we will see normal value of serum bilirubin, what is direct and indirect bilirubin, difference between hyperbilirubinemia, latent jaundice and jaundice, types of hyperbilirubinemia with their lab findings, and depending on the lab findings, differential diagnosis of jaundice. Normal serum total bilirubin is 0.2 to 0.8 mg per deciliter. Unconjugated or indirect bilirubin is 0.2 to 0.6 mg per deciliter. And conjugated or direct bilirubin is 0 to 0.2 mg per deciliter. Why they are called direct and indirect bilirubin? To understand this, we should know the Vandenberg test, or also called as Diazo test. This test is used for qualitative as well as quantitative estimation of serum bilirubin. The principle of the test is, bilirubin reacts with the diazo reagent, which is diazotized sulfanilic acid, to produce colored azo pigment. Conjugated bilirubin, being water soluble, gives color directly, but unconjugated bilirubin gives color only after addition of alcohol compound like methanol. Means it gives indirect positive Vandenberg test. So, to remember, unconjugated bilirubin, indirect bilirubin, and conjugated bilirubin, direct bilirubin. These indirect and direct bilirubin terms are being used in clinical practice. Now, if the serum total bilirubin exceeds 1 mg per deciliter, the condition is called hyperbilirubinemia. When this level is more than 2 mg per deciliter, it diffuses into the tissues and producing yellowish discoloration of sclera, conjunctiva, skin and mucous membrane, resulting in jaundice. Clinically, it is called icterus. But the serum total bilirubin is between 1 and 2 mg per deciliter, it indicates latent jaundice. So now we know what is hyperbilirubinemia, now we will see types of hyperbilirubinemia. It is of a three type. First is congenital hyperbilirubinemia, second is neonatal hyperbilirubinemia, and adult type of hyperbilirubinemia. Congenital includes Crigler-Najjar syndrome, Gilbert's disease, Dubin-Johnson syndrome, and Rotter's syndrome. Neonatal jaundice includes physiological jaundice, breast milk jaundice, and pathological neonatal jaundice. In adults, prehepatic or hemolytic jaundice, hepatic or infective jaundice, and posthepatic or obstructive jaundice. We will see all these one by one in brief, so this video will be little bit longer, so have patience. We will start with Crigler-Najjar syndrome. It is due to the deficiency of the enzyme UDP glucuronyl transferase. This enzyme is responsible for conjugation of bilirubin and makes it water soluble. I have made full video on heme catabolism, you can see in the card. Crigler-Najjar syndrome is of a two type, type 1 and type 2. Type 1 is a severe condition due to complete deficiency of this enzyme. Child usually do not survive beyond 2 years of life. Jaundice usually appears within 24 hours of life, not this point. As the conjugation process is hampered, unconjugated bilirubin level increases to more than 20 mg per deciliter and Kernig Terrace results. In this condition, liver transplant is the only available treatment. In contrast, type 2 is milder form as there is a partial deficiency of this enzyme. Only second stage of conjugation is deficient. So, only mild to moderate rise of bilirubin. Unconjugated bilirubin does not exceed 20 mg per deciliter. Usually, treatment with phenobarbital improves the jaundice. So in Crigler-Najjar syndrome, unconjugated indirect bilirubin is increased. Next is Gilbert's disease. It was believed to be due to a defect in the uptake of bilirubin by liver. More recent evidence points to mutation in the promoter region of UGT1 gene. In Gilbert's disease, bilirubin level is usually less than 6 mg per deciliter and patient is asymptomatic except mild jaundice. So it is a benign condition and requires no treatment. So in Gilbert's disease also, unconjugated or indirect bilirubin is increased. Next is Dubin-Johnson syndrome. It is an autosomal recessive trait leading to defect in excretion of conjugated bilirubin due to mutation of a gene MOAT multispecific organic anion transporter or MRP2 multi-drug resistance associated protein 2. So this ATP-dependent organic anion transporter in bile canaliculi is defective. So this bilirubin cannot be transported to bile canaliculi and gets deposited in the liver. This condition is called black liver jaundice. Serum bilirubin level seldom rise to 5 to 6 mg per deciliter. Patients often have normal aminotransferases level but have conjugated hyperbilirubinemia. It is also a benign condition and requires no treatment. Last congenital hyperbilirubinemia is Rotor syndrome. It is a similar condition with the Dubin-Johnson syndrome, but exact defect is not identified. Bilirubin excretion is defective, but there is no staining of liver. Here also, there is a conjugated hyperbilirubinemia. It is also a benign condition and requires no treatment. So, unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia is seen in Crigler-Najjar syndrome and Gilbert's disease, whereas conjugated hyperbilirubinemia is seen in Dubin-Johnson syndrome and Rotor syndrome. After all congenital jaundice, now we will see neonatal jaundice. Jaundice seen in newborn babies is called neonatal jaundice. First, we will see physiological jaundice. This transient hyperbilirubinemia is due to an accelerated rate of destruction of RBCs and also because of the immature hepatic system of conjugation of bilirubin in newborn. Typically, jaundice appears 48 to 72 hours after birth. Mind well, congenital jaundice appears within 24 hours of birth. Unconjugated bilirubin does not rise much, it will be around 10 to 15 mg per deciliter. Jaundice usually returns to normal in 1 to 2 weeks, but it may require phototherapy. It is important to note that child is not born with jaundice but develop it few days after birth. So this is all about physiological jaundice. Now we will see breast milk jaundice. In some breastfed infant, prolongation of physiological jaundice is seen. It is because high level of estrogen derivatives in the maternal blood, which is excreted through milk. This would inhibit the glucuronyl transferase system of the conjugation of bilirubin. So breast milk jaundice is nothing but the prolongation of physiological jaundice. Now we'll see the pathological neonatal jaundice, hemolytic disease of newborn, that is Rh incompatibility. When a Rh negative mother has a Rh positive fetus, there is sensitization of mother's immune system of Rh antigen. This occurs most frequently at the time of delivery due to separation of placenta when fetus RBC mixed with the maternal immune cells. First child often escapes, but in second pregnancy, the Rh antibody will pass from mother to the fetus. Because of the severe response, they would start destroying the fetal RBCs even before birth. Sometimes child is born with severe hemolytic disease. This referred to as erythroblastosis fetalis. This disease can be prevented by the administration of antibodies to Rh antigen to mother during antenatal period or within 48 to 72 hours of first delivery. Coombs test is done to diagnose Rh incompatibility. Now we'll see the treatment part of the neonatal jaundice. Mild to moderate neonatal jaundice is usually managed by phototherapy. Exposure of a child to ultraviolet light converts the water-insoluble Z isomer of bilirubin to water-soluble E isomer. Secondly, glucuronyl transferase enzyme can be induced by phenobarbital if phototherapy fails. When bilirubin level in the blood rises 20 to 25 milligram per deciliter, there will be chances of permanent brain damage, that is cornic teras. To prevent this, exchange blood transfusion is the only option. After neonatal jaundice, now we'll see jaundice of adults. First we'll see prehepatic jaundice. This condition is seen when there is increased rate of hemolysis. Causes of the increased rate of hemolysis are abnormal shape of RBC, that is congenital spherocytosis, enzyme deficiency like G6PD deficiency, pyruvate kinase deficiency, autoimmune hemolytic anemia, or toxins like carbon tetrachloride. As the increased rate of hemolysis is there, the characteristic feature is the increase in unconjugated bilirubin in blood. Other findings are absence of bilirubin urea, excessive excretion of urobilinogen in urine that can be detected by Ehrlich test, and excessive excretion of urobilinogen and stercobilinogen in feces. Second is hepatic jaundice. In pure hepatocellular disease, conjugation in liver is decreased and hence free bilirubin unconjugated is increased in circulation. Inflammatory edema of hepatocytes often compresses the intracellular canaliculi at the site of bile formation and produces an element of obstruction. So conjugated bilirubin is reabsorbed back into the circulation and a mixed type of jaundice is seen. The lab findings will be high level of unconjugated and conjugated bilirubin in blood, urinary urobilinogen is low or normal, and conjugated bilirubin, as it is water soluble, seen in urine. Causes of the hepatic jaundice are mainly infective, hepatitis virus A, B, C, D or E, hepatotoxic drugs like chloroform, antitubercular drugs, etc. Finally, now we will see post-hepatic jaundice or obstructive jaundice. This type of jaundice occurs due to obstruction to the flow of the bile, so conjugated bilirubin is not secreted into the intestine. Causes are divided into intrahepatic obstruction and extrahepatic obstruction. First, we will see intrahepatic obstruction. That includes chronic active hepatitis, lymphomas, primary hepatoma, and obstructive stage of viral hepatitis. Extrahepatic obstructive causes are first stones either in gallbladder or in biliary tract. Second is atresia of bile duct, then carcinoma of head of pancreas, and last, enlarged lymph glands in the porta hepatis. Lab findings of the obstructive jaundice will be conjugated hyperbilirubinemia, conjugated bilirubin appears in urine as it is water soluble, bile salts appears in urine, clay colored stool as these pigments cannot secrete it into the gut. And finally, this is the differential diagnosis on basis of lab findings of prehepatic, hepatic and posthepatic jaundice. So this is all about hyperbilirubinemias, congenital, neonatal and hyperbilirubinemias of adults. If you find this video informative, then please do like and share this video and also subscribe my channel. Thank you.